Do you think that, so obviously there's a movement out there to see secular Buddhism. Stephen has informed people and has triggered that interest and has given a structure where people can gather around, because I think he's inspired by Stephen too, isn't he?
Oh yeah,
Absolutely.
very much.
So Stephen has given us like a scaffolding to stand on. We feel on safe grounds whilst arguing about secular Buddhism, because kind of he's Stephen has done the legwork and sorted this out, that we don't just kind of flounder about there and leave certain bits out that we don't like, but what are we left with? That's what it's done for me. It's given me that confidence that we haven't left anything out that would matter, but we so that this can work. Secular Buddhism can work, and then creative Buddhism. I learned that in the course, a lot was from Europe, but that is what it is really about, and that way it could be developed. So, do you think that? So, there's this movement of secular and then creative dharma. Is it that it is so difficult to create a platform for what we are thinking about, this kind of interactive space? Is it just technically much more difficult to a newsletter, or is that really something that no one else is inspired to do? Because I'm interested that, so there's this great new thing of creative dharma and coming up with an old-fashioned top-down newsletter. That intrigues me, which for me is not so creative. So is it the technicality of it which is restricting, or is it we are thinking differently to these other guys?
No, there are technical issues. Now, you could trigger in me a very, very long rant about how things were in the olden days. But I shall spare you for the time being, because I want to rant about other things too. But the thing is that these top-down paradigms are actually relatively new in terms of the internet. And when I mean top-down paradigms, I'm talking about web platforms and newsletters and private news lists, email mailing lists. But like I said, in the olden days, things were different. Things were certainly one hell of a lot more chaotic, and the technology was pretty primitive in those days. But the lateral connections that were possible using the technology then, which was essentially email and a thing called news groups, which was actually just a massive free-for-all forum with tens of thousands of different forums, all of which you could cross-post to and do all sorts of interesting things. And that top technology actually still exists. The protocols exist, the port numbers exist, but news groups these days, no one's ever heard of them. But that used to be the internet. That was the internet before the web came along. And so the technology is actually there, a very old technology lying sort of almost unused. But this is just one option I'm thinking about in terms of how to try to get back to some sort of much more lateralized discourse. But there are so yeah there are technical problems for people these days, because we're basically being given here's your website, here's your newsletter and your mailing list, and forget about anything, forget about automatic communications between between sites or locations or people. So the problem is, first of all, that people aren't familiar with the way things were done back in the olden days. And the actual technology to actually implement that and integrate it into websites and social media platforms doesn't quite exist yet. And I'm still thinking about all the technicalities involved in doing that. That's going to take me a while to think through. But anyway, that I think is the situation at the moment in terms of digital discourse, because that's what we've got these days. I don't think you could say that there's very, very little discourse that happens in the world today that isn't mediated by the internet, and in particular, websites and social media platforms.
So it's a bit of both. It's technically not known anymore.
Yeah, technically and, not known, and it's or, and also, not used.
And it's not used, and therefore, indeed, thinking doesn't tend to go there. That's not what is in everyone's mind to create as a platform.
Well, I guess the problem here is that, you know, people like to use various and different types of media or ways to access the things they want to read about or learn about or interact with. We've seen that, you know, social media platforms have pretty much completely wiped out all the old web forums that used to exist as independent websites. I used to own some of those. I used to have a lot of forums, you know, in the early 2000s.
Did you?
Oh yes. Oh, well, I've had forums for years, but I had quite a number going in that particular time. And when Facebook came along, my forum and dozens of other, and probably millions, who knows? Well, it wasn't quite overnight, but it was fairly dramatic that, you know, everybody's attention went to the social media platform that gave them what they wanted, which was basically everything on the plate, rather than just going to sort of one particular silo of a website and doing all your interaction on one website, then moving to another website. And so, you know, Facebook and other social media platforms pretty much destroyed independent forums in the early 2000s. And not out of any malice, it was just, they were just better systems. That's what people wanted. Mm. So that this is the way of technology. It constantly changes. You just have to move with it, not sort of complain about it. So, you know, it's really a matter of, you know, trying to look at the technology that exists, the protocols that exist, and the programs that exist, and trying to sort of see if there's some way of rejuvenating this old technology and making it useful again. And I think it could be particularly useful in terms of mailing lists, but not only mailing lists along with multiple different media simultaneously. So people don't have to go to the email to sort of read all the threads on the forums or groups that they're following, but can also go to a website where all the same content has been posted in a laid out fashion. So they could be on a mailing list, for example, receiving messages from a particular group on a particular thread, perhaps. And if they wanted to respond to that particular thread, they could just do it by replying to that email to the emailing list, and that emailing list would automatically distribute it to all the email people on the emailing list to begin with, but would also simultaneously post that and update a web type forum with all the same content. So, but yeah, then there's more to it than that. But essentially, it's a question of trying to make it as frictionless as possible and giving people as many options as possible, because people's preferences are very different. And it could also include social media, of course, automatic posting to social media. But yeah, I think, yeah, there's I still have a lot to do, and I will probably need quite a few months of programming to actually get it to work. And I don't really have time to do that at the moment. I'm trying to find some time post maybe September, when hopefully things have calmed down a bit. And perhaps I have time to take a sabbatical so I can do all these things in a more serious manner. But I'll just have to see what the situation is come September. Because, you know, things, you know, at the moment do require my attention. So, yeah. But anyway, yeah, I'd like to talk about cricket.
Okay.
Go for it.
well, in fact, I guess cricket is really just a preamble to what I want to talk about. I don't know that... I think Elfie, you're probably the only person here that really doesn't know anything about cricket and really doesn't want to know. as a punishment to people, I used to explain to them the rules of cricket. You know, it's extremely soporific.
What, like your children?
I mean, knowing the rules of cricket is excruciating. It really is excruciating. It's an excruciating sport.
You know, I don't know much about cricket, but I do know that.
Exactly. Well, you pretty well know everything you need to know about cricket, but I'm going to do some more stuff anyway. So cricket is rather boring. In fact, it's so boring. Obviously, I don't know whether any of you have been to a cricket match, like a test match or anything like that before.
I have been to many cricket. I'm a big fan.
Oh, good.
Are you
good,
a big fan? Good. Oh, yeah. My God.
Well, I wouldn't say that in public, but, you know.
No, me and my son are both big cricket fans.
So what do you do there when nothing happens?
Well, that's the thing. Exactly.
You drink.
It's sort of like a zen. You know, you sort of got this Zen thing going where all you're doing is sitting in sort of 40 degree heat, you know, with a tinny in your hand, looking at the grass grow. And you do that for, you know, 8-10 hours, and then it stops. And nothing has happened, really, on the field.
Well, I have a much more sinister view on this, I'm afraid, and you wouldn't be surprised, would you?
this sort of, you know, incessant boredom can go on, you know, for 5 days, you know, and at the end of the 5 days, you know, it'll be a draw because no one really won, and, you know, well, and that's cricket.
You know, right.
It's... But, you know, there's also sorts of very strange things can happen in cricket. One particularly interesting thing particularly from an Australian side, up against the old enemy, is sledging. There's this concept of sledging. Have you heard of that, Rupert?
Oh, yes, sledging. Indeed. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
we're in Australia. What?
Sledging.
Wedging.
Snow, sledge, like in the snow,
Okay, sledging, like in the snow. Sledging. Okay, of course, yes.
Now, sledging is actually where the fine art of cricket really comes in. So it's certainly you've got to have technical capabilities and all things like that. But winning or losing usually comes down to sledging, which is just a matter of, you know, how can you, because, you know, you've got a batsman, you know, sitting there 22 yards from the bowler. You get a fastball come in and they'll pitch this extremely heavy, hard ball. I don't know, well, you haven't perhaps held a cricket ball before, but they are really heavy and they are really hard.
They are weapons.
They are.
Exactly. Now, when those things come down the pitch at, you know, I don't know, 100 miles an hour, depending on the bowler, of course, it's pretty terrifying, you know. It's pretty terrifying. A top-notch batsman has to keep that has to be absolute total focus, and it's really easy to break that focus by triggering their amygdala. They're basically getting, you know, the bowler will sort of say things to the batsman about his personal life, about his wife, about his parents, about something that happened, and basically emotionally destabilizing.
Is that what's done?
That's sledging.
That's sledging.
Is sledging. In that moment,
so you just go past them and said, saw your wife the other day, or whatever. And
exactly. well, the wicketkeeper does that too. The wicketkeeper will be sort of, you know, having a little, you know, talk to the batsman while he's trying to concentrate.
Okay,
you know, basically talking about, you know,
have you put on weight? Yeah.
Well, yeah. Much, much worse stuff than that, I can tell you. Much, much worse. This stuff really cuts to the heart. You know, it's brutal. And during that moment where they've been emotionally disrupted, they can't concentrate. They can't see the ball anymore. Their cognitive facilities have been, you know, detached, and it's all the amygdala that's actually, you know, activated. And while you're in that emotional state, you can't do anything properly. You can't concentrate. You're not going to see that ball. No, there's no way you're going to see that ball if you've been triggered in such a manner. So, you know, I thought that was, that really is what cricket is all about, is emotional destabilization of the batsman.
Wow.
But anyway.
Rupert, agree.
Well, I'm not sure that's all that it's about. It's certainly at
well, I'm watching grass.
Yes. But, no. I mean, I think the point is, as you've just said, it is a very... It's actually a very intriguing game. I don't know about the nature of cricket. It's the point is it's a very complex game. It can be a very simple game, but it can at the high level work on lots of different levels. It works on a physical skill level, but it also works on an intellectual level, and as you say, it works on an emotional level. There aren't many games where all of those things can happen. I mean, in football, there isn't a great deal of the emotional, intellectual stuff going on. It happens far too fast. But in cricket, there is. There is a lot of chess that goes on in cricket. Mm-hmm. And chess doesn't have the physical side of things. So actually, it can... The reason it's successful, the reason people go and watch it, is because it has a lot of complexity. But that beside the point. But I agree with you, absolutely, in terms of there is something about the Dharma in terms of reactivity that goes on and the destabilization and focus. And a lot of batsmen and a lot of fielders practice mindfulness because it encourages and enhances their focus. A fielder also has the slip fielder, particularly, and I think it's hard for a batsman. It's very hard for a slip fielder because they have to stand there and crouch for days, hours and hours, and absolutely nothing happens because the ball doesn't even come to them. But once every couple of hours, it might. And at that moment, they have to be entirely focused and they have to be able to react amazingly fast. And that is an enormously difficult skill. And it's sort of interesting that some people can manage it and that switch on and off the focus. So I think that there's probably quite a lot of, there's probably a lot that could be written about the Dharma of cricket.
Brilliant.
But it's a sort of I'm not sure I'd want to write it.
That is cool. I never knew
This is just a preamble, actually.
Okay, cool.
To something else, right. I want to talk about, which is another game.
Good.
another game called Brandies. Now, I don't know whether you've heard of that.
What? B?
It's a child's game. Kids in school play it, called Brandy.
Brandy.
Brandy, as in the drink. Right.
No, not in the drink. No.
But it's spelled the same way.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, it is spelled the same way. Yeah. Oh, when you said brandy, I thought, my God, I didn't know you were into the drink, you know?
Yeah. Yes.
Well, brandy.
Well, you will see the connection and why it's called brandy. I'll have to describe it. You know, usually when... certainly in my day at primary school, we'd turn up at school, you know, at 8 o'clock and probably spend an hour just out in the field sort of mucking about. And one of the most popular games played was a game called Brandy. It usually involved a tennis ball and probably, you know, 10 to 20 boys, usually, nearly always boys, and the object was the person with the ball had to chase any one of these people and hit them as hard as they could with the ball, and once they did that, they were branded. They could pick up the ball and go taunt someone else, in which they can sort of inflict injury upon someone else. And so there was an awful lot of running involved, people running for their lives, not wanting to get sort of hit by a fast-moving tennis ball, which could probably cause a small bruise if it's thrown hard enough. And so that was sort of the game. It was just sort of an awful lot of running around, panicking and pain But that's sort of that sort of entry level brandy. There's sort of a next level. And that level involves using a cricket ball. So it gets more interesting. All of a sudden it's more life and death than because the amount of running is far more panicked. The pain inflicted, of course, if you just happen to get hit. And it was actually, people getting hit was actually rarer when we used the cricket ball than when we used the tennis ball, for the obvious reason, people were running a lot faster. you really, really wouldn't want to get hit by one of these balls, but that's what we did because we were boys. That's what boys do. I guess the thing is, at the end of a particular game, you could sort of walk in the class with all sorts of bruises on your legs or wherever. And it was brutal, it was dangerous, and it was, quite useful as a life learning message, you could say. But I've never actually heard of anybody else playing cricket ball brandy before, and I'm just sort of wondering whether anybody else had.
No, not in my school. We throw lots of things at each other, but not No, I can't recall.
Yes. It's an extremely dangerous game. Certainly, you know, any of my kids caught playing that would get a good talking to. But it's a, I guess it's that. Well, the thing is, too, that is that the way the actual groups operated was quite interesting as well. You'd have a group of people who were ostensibly in the game playing this game, Brandy. But of course, being a running game, the field of play moved constantly all over, because we had really big playing fields, and so it could wander all over the place. And it would often wander into other playing fields which were completely unrelated to this particular game of Brandy. And of course, when you're running for your life, you're not really worried about anybody else's field of play. And so what happened then was that many non-participants were turned into participants by being unilaterally branded, and then in order to take up their revenge, they would pick up the ball and start chasing whoever was responsible for it, and so the number of participants increased as a result of the field of play sort of moving into other fields of play, and people reacting to being either deliberately or accidentally hit by a ball of various weights. So it's interesting interactions between different fields of play and how they interacted with each other and how they responded. And people, even when people were not in that particular game, they were forced into the game as a result of being sort of hit by some hard object. So this sort of reactive, almost fission-like pattern.
Can I ask how often it happened that it was it began to just be between two people
into tribal groups? We have various playing. Fields or fields of play going on, which are different from each other, and when you get these intersections of them and crossing over of them, the inevitability sometimes of conflict and drawing other people into a conflict they didn't actually have anything to do with. So interesting interactions.
Yeah.
Well, that's all I wanted to talk about, Brandy. Nothing more. I don't know if there's any lessons there.
Oh, I thought this was going to lead into some interesting Dharmic insight.
It does. I was thinking of it in terms of, group theory and the way that, groups respond as sometimes respond as singular animals, singular organisms. So, and the conflicts between various groups as interests are violated. So there's a few different things like that. And I guess one of the main things is that this was a very, very organic children's game, and it very, I think, quite well demonstrates, a type of preparation, I guess, for life and the things that can happen in life. That sometimes pain is involved. Sometimes, quite a lot of pain. Sometimes there are a low stakes. Sometimes there are very high stakes, especially when you bring out the cricket ball. So it's just interesting, psychologically interesting that children sort of feel the need to play these sorts of games.
Well, as you rightly said, boys do. Huh?
Exactly.
I think there is such a, that is one way of interacting, And it seems to be, to me, a very male way of interacting. This is not the games that I played now. And I wouldn't have taken part in it, I'm sure.
Well, they very, very rarely did, except when the playing field intersected with their particular playing field. And sometimes, you know, a girl might get hit because someone missed and hit somebody else, a non-participant. And, you know, sometimes the girl would react and sometimes they would. But there seemed to be a general rule that if a girl was involved, you know, you didn't give her up as much force as you would on your best friend, for example. So there seems to be that these very strong underlying understandings, which, you know, may be part cultural, but I think are probably largely biological. Where, you know, creating hurt against female non-participants it wasn't even a rule, it was just something you just didn't do. So yeah, a very, very strange, the rules were sort of, very organic, and sometimes very brutal. But I think, you know, very useful as well in terms of what you have to learn about a life or living life. And it's like a preparation for sort of, you know.
Preparation, but also a continuation of that style of interacting, isn't it? It's not necessarily, that's what every boy needs to learn. To interact well. No, maybe that's an introduction in how to preserve the existing culture rather than improve the existing culture, perhaps. I don't know. You know, is that the best way of making group decisions or interacting in a group? I'm not sure.
Yeah, well, yes, it's, you basically have, you know say 10 boys against one boy with a ball, but they were one group, you know. There was a tribal sort of feeling to that particular group at that time playing that particular game. There was a camaraderie that, you know, we're doing something here which is a little bit dangerous. That, you know, could get you hurt, and when you bring out the cricket ball, high stakes.
Interesting that it is in an Australian boyhood, huh? The kind of pioneer, male pioneer spirit, where you against the elements, and you'd better be quick, and you better don't take any prisoners, and I'm sure it's exhilarating.
Oh, it is. but you know, the thing is with these exhilarating cricket ball brandy is that it never lasted longer than maybe a couple of days in succession. After that, people started to get a little bit, maybe just too much adrenaline too often.
Too many.
Let's go back to a tennis ball. You know? But you know, strangely enough, it wasn't Australian boys. Well, there were Australian boys there, but half the school were recent English migrants. So in some ways, the game was an acculturalization for all these recent, soft boys from England, and sort of bringing them into what I guess we thought was normality. And sledging is part of that. Sledging has actually got its it's very, very deep in Australian culture, and certainly used to be. It's a form of testing. Basically trying to push someone to their limits and just sort of define where that limit is. And the game is that you don't react. If you know somebody's trying to push you and push you and push you, If you react, you lost. So the idea is you do not react to sledging. You just let it wash over you. And that's a very, very strong Australian culture. People find this, sometimes certain kinds of Australians are very, they seem to be very aggressive, saying very sort of seemingly nasty things. But it's a form of a test. Can you take it? Are you going to react? If you overreact, then you lost. If you don't react, you're in. It's a very common thing in Australian male culture.
Is that the same kind of reactivity that we aspire to in the Dharma?
I think so.
Or non-reactive, so. Yeah.
It's non-reactivity. You cannot react. If you react, you lost. So the idea is, to be, let yourself be pushed, but not to react in an emotional way. Because once you've done that, you've lost the game. But if you don't react, there's sort of, you can be sort of a form of, a form of acceptance, an acceptance into a particular group. If you can take that sort of, it's not really abuse, but testing. You can take that sort of testing. And that sort of sledging sort of carried over into cricket, of course. Now everybody does it, I think, English as well. So
I think there is something here that might be useful, might be interesting. And I've come across it in a couple of different situations. The first one was when I was at work, before I was interested in Buddhism, Dharma, reactivity or anything. And that was, there was a guy at work who I really didn't get on with. And it was in the university. He was in a different part of the university from me, but I had to interact with him because he was head of the technicians who I had to work with. And I knew that he created reactivity. I didn't know what it was called then, but he would get me going. And he would get me going even before I would speak to him. So the anticipation of having a conversation created reactivity. And I just, after a while, I recognized that if I thought about phoning him up, I could create the reactivity. And so I did. I used to just think about phoning him up without phoning him up, or writing him an email without writing him an email, in order to create the reactivity, which I could then control. So I used it as a practice. I used it. And this is before I was practicing, before I came across Buddhism, because it meant that I could calm myself. And so that when I was actually having the conversation, I wasn't so reactive, because I used to be quite a, I don't think I am now, but I used to be get quite angry quite quickly with people who I felt were incompetent or stupid or in positions of power that they really didn't ought to be. It was a technique that I sort of taught myself, and I've mentioned this to a couple of people who have sort of come into the similar situations as a technique for practice. So it becomes something that you deliberately practice, because when we've been talking about reactivity with Stephen, it's about reacting to situations, the second arrow and stuff. But actually, if you practice it without the arrow, the anticipation of the arrow, it's much easier, because you're not actually in there, but you're creating the neural pathways that won't be reacted when the arrow actually hits you unexpectedly. And in fact, I remember I was doing it yesterday. I had my drawing class yesterday. We were doing our mindful drawing. And I was saying that the thing about the drawing is to only look at what it is that you're drawing and don't look down at the picture. Because if you look down at the picture, then you create a reactivity because you're looking at how good or bad your picture is. Whereas, of course, it's an irrelevance, because what's interesting is looking and seeing, and that's the point. That's the meditative quality of it. We just use the pencil to help us focus. But when we look down, we automatically see a picture and react to the picture. So I was saying to the people I was working with that this is a way of training yourself, because before you look down, you know how you're going to be reacting. So you anticipate it. And then when you actually look down, you think about how you're reacting. So you shift from a position of second arrow reactivity to a training, a where you are anticipating and then seeing. So it becomes something that after a while becomes sort of second nature. And instead of feeling a reactivity, you notice instead. So it shifts from something out of control to something which is under control. And I hadn't really thought about this much, but it does strike me that there isn't, or I've not come across anything in the Dharmic teachings that we've been doing with Stephen. Thank you very much. That cover this idea of practicing with sort of real events, or by creating the facsimile of an event in order to help you practice. So it's not quite the same as meditation, where you're just watching things, any old thing that could happen, but you're deliberately making things happen because you know that normally they would create reactivity, but you're doing it in a controlled situation. And I don't know whether there's that. I mean, that's the play thing, is doing it naturally. I think that's just what we do as part of play. We create situations so that perhaps we know how to react to them later on, but we don't do it with a sort of formal exercises. And I just I wondered. So it struck me that that's something that is a sort of useful. If I was teaching secular Dharma, I think that'd be one of the things I would be suggesting, is that you create situations where you deliberately create a controlled reactivity.
Lots of games have that in it, don't they? I mean, it's like a three-year-old, you play a board game and then they're losing, and they might well wipe the board, mightn't they? So what you're building up is the capacity to lose without losing it. And that is not non-reactivity. So this building up those fibers in the brain that have the inhibiting of what would be the spontaneous reaction to it, like an uprising of anger or defense or whatever. And you want to build up the capacity and willingness to inhibit those behaviors. And that's what it would be, non-reactivity. I guess that could be in any game. And then it's still a difference. Are you building up the capacity to just not show, but you harbor the grudge, all right? You wait for another, you know, moment, and you kind of let them fall over your foot in the hallway in the school because they just had you with a cricket ball. Or are you really going for the non-reactivity? Well, and there, I think that might go either way. I think a lot of people have just learned not to show reactivity, but they're reactive all right. Mm-hmm. It's just kept inside, huh?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And it brings us back to this whole point about the sort of the compassionate nature, the, whether that's a natural phenomena or whether it's a it's a learnt skill, and I'm still sort of ambiguous about it. But it also relates to another thing, and so does what sort of tangentially what Gary's been talking about, which I've just finished another book, which is called No Self, No Problem, and it's got a crap title, but actually it's one of the best books I've read about the relationship between modern psychology and Buddhist Dharmic thinking on the self. So I would highly recommend it. I'll send you a link. It's quite short, and it brings together quite a few of the things that we've been talking about. And the premise is that there is no self, and this is so he's sort of coming from a position of not Stephen's non-self, where Stephen is sort of ambiguous about the teaching, but a very straightforward no, yeah, it doesn't exist, and then looks at it from from the science, and brings in quite a lot of how this has been something within the Buddhist and Taoist traditions. And so I found it very interesting, because I think it sort of starts from a principle which I agreed with, which, so it's always good to read a book where you think I agree with what this guy is talking about. And there were a few things where he was going off a bit, and I thought, well, I'm not sure about this, but in general, and I'd always thought that in the sessions where Stephen, where we were looking at non-self, or that Stephen was never committed to that aspect of Buddhism. And then I remember, because I was so interested in it, I was always very keen on listening to what he was saying in these sessions. And he would talk about the Buddha never, or Gautama, never saying that he didn't exist, or that he always referring to himself in the first person, or that there was no sense of that Gautama didn't think of himself as being a self, having a self. And I wondered whether this is to do with the nature of us, and particularly of in this case of Stephen, because it's a difficult thing to accept and also accept of what you are, what we are. When I first, in the first session I think I ever had with Stephen, which was at Gaia House in a group tutorial thing, and I wanted to talk about the self, and I raised it, and I was saying about, I was really interested in not self, and he immediately said, no, it's not self, it's non-self. And this is, I don't know, about 5 years ago, maybe, I don't know. And then he went on to explain, in terms of which I didn't understand at the time, about what non-self was, but it wasn't. And he said that, don't worry, you're not going to disappear in a puff of smoke. And when I discussed it with Martine, she said the same thing, same words. Don't worry, you're not going to disappear in a puff of smoke. And I never thought I would. I never thought that this was this is what it meant. And so I just wonder whether in what we've been doing in secular Dharma is trying to hold on to the idea of self, individuality and self within the Dharmic, within a Dharmic context. So self does exist in the bachelor version of secular Dharma. And I don't think it does exist. I think it's an illusion. I think it is something that it's an incredibly difficult illusion to not be within. But in this book, it does talk about that. It talks about the fact that, yes, there is no self, and it is an illusion. And I was quite pleased, because that's not many people that I've read were prepared to say it's an illusion. They'll use other words, but not the fact that it's an illusion. And I one of the reasons I think it is because within drawing, at times, I get the sense of not a non-object subject duality, that there isn't somebody doing a drawing. There is just an experience. And I think that it is possible. And a lot of what's going, he talks about in the book, is about the left and right hand hemispheres, and about the right hand hemisphere, the holistic nature of this, and the visual nature, and the non-language based nature. And that it is the language based center which has created the self. And if we don't have that, we don't have self, which sort of makes sense in terms of animals not having selves because they don't have language. Anyway, I recommend the book. It's quite short, and it's sort of easily, I mean, I listen to it, but it's, I'd imagine, easily under read or listened to. And I think it's interesting because it's a different type of way of looking at secular Dharma than we've been doing, which brings me back to the nature of secular Dharma, which I think you were talking about, Alfie, right at the beginning. Are we building on Stephen's, the Bachelor Secular Dharma? Or is that something which is important, but not necessarily a base from which to build? Is it the thing? Just got an echo. Is it the thing from which everything comes and everything is built upon? Or is it something that sits at a side and there are other things here which are also as relevant, other philosophies, other ideas? Or does it sit underneath and everything has to come from that? There is my question. Did you understand? Did that make sense, the question?
Yeah.
All right.
That makes sense, yeah.
What's the answer?
I think it's one ladder. It's not even the only ladder, you know. So you can crawl up that one, and lots of people will be very happy with that. Even Stephen has already discovered other ladders, like Stoicism and Epicureanism, and they're all kind of climbing up the same wall, I think. And then there are you can put planks between the two ladders.
Wow, brilliant.
Three ladders, can't you? And
yeah.
And walk along them. So it's one structure, it's not by no means the only structure. It makes much more sense of Buddhism, I think. So I think it is for me a meaningful next step for Buddhism, but most Buddhists wouldn't agree, I guess. but you know, they're climbing up a different ladder, a different wall. If I'm into religion, then that is the big, that's a bigger change probably of, you know, that's a different angle. That's a different, if you think of it as a 3D, it's just
brilliant. Off. It's fantastic.
I'm climbing up the apex of this house on my secular Dharma ladder, you know, dabbling with other, you know, I'm also quite like a Heideggerian ladder and find the commonalities. Sometimes I have a foot on either. But the Buddhists and all the religions, they may be climbing up a different face of that building, huh? So they're around the corner for me. They're still climbing. I wish them luck. but they are fundamentally different too. Maybe we just, you know, we look over the corner and say, oh, they're climbing over there. I don't know. And I hope that they're noticing that they are also, you know, if they're different religions, are not so different, and hopefully they find their commonalities and put a few planks in between the two, the ladders, so that we are not all just assuming that we got the only answer. I don't know, I'd never, you know, an answer to your thing about non-self and not self. It's not such a big question for me. I have such a just a working policy with that, you know. And I have difficulties when you say, you know, this guy says the self is only an illusion. Any thought is, you know, I don't see where the difference is between any mental image or happening to the building of a self. It's just happenings in my in my little clearing of consciousness. So you appear in it, and I appear in it in the same way, like an object. So that can be contemplated. So I don't see, it has no problematic for me in that way. It's just another phenomenon. And it can be very much identified with. But, you know, if I'm in the right mode, I identify with any possession of mine. You know, I drove an MG. My God, did I identify with that? For a good long while, you know. I didn't need an eye. I had an MG. So I don't, I see that as nothing particular. You know, it's just another thing that pops up from time to time. Indeed, like you, I'm very happiest in flow when there's no sight of it. There's no eye in full flow of drawing something or gardening or, you know, watching you and discussing with you. Often there is really no, there is no I. There is just listening and speaking. And then it comes in again. So that was a bit daft or whatever, you know, when I, about myself. Often. So, but it's just nothing to, I do not feel that urge to fight it out in a way, because for me it's a phenomenon. It's incredible how it pops up and has force, but so have many other things.
Well, it's interesting. I suppose it's, for me, it's more revolutionary, the idea of non-self. It's not something that I've come across until I sort of came across it within the Buddhist context, and it's not something that I'd recognized explicitly, and now that I do, I've become sort of intrigued by it, and also by its impact on everything and everybody. So when I look at, in terms of politics, you sort of, you think, do you know that what you are as a, is this a self? So if you look at a politician and you're asking the question, are they aware of this? And if they were, would they act differently? And I think the answer must be yes, because you would feel in a different position. And I also think it relates to groups and the, And it relates to individuality and the whole nature of what we, our societies now in the West, have become very individualistic, which relates back again to what Gary was saying about the game thing, about the way that you as a group, you can create groups and you can have a group identity when you're playing, and it becomes natural, and it is a natural thing. But we've pretty much got rid of a lot of that because we have developed such a strong sense of the importance of the individual. And that is related to the self. And that's, if that is an illusion, so then maybe the the idea of a individual is also an illusion. And then you start thinking about human rights and what do they mean, and are they to do with the collective humanity, or are they to do with individual humans? So it becomes a broader philosophical question and sociological question. But anyway, I find it raises all sorts of other things, and other ways of looking and perceiving, and how other people might think and perceive. But we're down to less than a minute, yeah. And time.
Oh, that was lovely. Last thoughts. That's I can engage with that really well. Yeah, nice. Let's continue that.
Yeah. So maybe that would be my theme for next week if we have a chance.
Cool. Yeah. Okay. Good to see you guys.
Okay. Lovely to see you.
Brilliant. Have a good week, huh?
Okay then. Yeah. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.
See you later.
Bye.